Did you think space was silent? Well, it might be for audio or compression waves. But what if you were in orbit around Saturn, listening for radio and plasma waves? The Cassini spacecraft, which orbited around Saturn for 15 years, had a radio and plasma wave science instrument on board that could pick up what you are hearing now, being emitted by Saturn and its moons. These radio waves have been compressed for our benefit, converting roughly 30 minutes worth of radio waves to a minute's worth of audio waves. This wasn't just done to create a creepy audio file, but it had real scientific purpose, which was to examine the source of these radio waves. In the case of this audio file, the source was Saturn's aurora. You see, the Sun is always blasting out bits of its mass in the form of electrically charged particles, called the solar wind. Planets with a magnetic field surrounding them redirect this solar wind around the planet to its poles, where the charged particles impact the planet's atmosphere, or more specifically, its ionosphere. This impact causes particles in the atmosphere to become excited, or in other words, the collision ionizes the particles in the atmosphere, causing them to emit electromagnetic radiation. We can see this ionization with our own eyes in visible light, but aurora also emit radio waves, which we need special instruments to detect, like the one that was on Cassini. These radio waves bounce around within the planet's magnetic field, which is where Cassini picked them up. How do we know this? Through another audio file. What you are listening to here is the Cassini spacecraft passing through the bow shock of Saturn's magnetosphere. As I mentioned, Saturn has a large magnetic field surrounding it, called the planet's magnetosphere, which deflects the solar wind around it. For the first section of the audio, Cassini is outside of Saturn's magnetosphere. Outside the magnetosphere, radio sources are quiet and there is calm in the audio. Then, Cassini's orbit takes it through the magnetosphere's boundary, called the bow shock, which is the place where the magnetic field and the solar wind collide. There is a sudden increase in radio waves. Past the bow shock, Cassini begins to detect a lot more radio waves bouncing around Saturn's magnetosphere, noticeably different from the outside of the magnetosphere. But Cassini heard a lot more than just aurora. Cassini also made some close approaches to Saturn, listening closely to the planet itself. Saturn has a thick and dynamic atmosphere, with massive storms spanning the planet. One such storm sounded like this. What you are listening to here are radio waves being generated by lightning in one of Saturn's storms. It may sound small and almost puny, but remember that this is not the representation of audio you're hearing. These lightning strikes are so powerful that Cassini could detect their radio waves in space. To give you some kind of scale, scientists estimate that the lightning in Saturn storms are roughly 1,000 times more powerful than typical lightning on Earth. To get this close to Saturn, Cassini had to pass through its rings. During flybys like this, Cassini listened. What do you think could be the cause of this audio? Cassini was traveling extremely fast around Saturn, as fast as 121,000 kilometers per hour. As it orbited through the Janus Epimetheus ring, a very faint and dusty ring, it would impact tiny particles, which would vaporize into clouds of plasma. These tiny charged explosions could then be picked up by Cassini's radio and plasma wave science instrument, and these impacts were then converted into the audio you are now hearing. The increased frequency of these impacts showed the densest part of the ring, and as the impact subsided, it indicated that Cassini was moving away from the ring again. Cassini tried this again later in the mission, except this time through a gap between Saturn and the D-ring. You'll notice this time that there wasn't a noticeable increase in collisions. At first, scientists thought that this was because the gaps between the rings were just really barren of particles. However, a second orbit through the gap revealed something different. This time, and every orbit after that, there was a noticeable increase in particle collisions. So, what happened the first time? Well, as it turns out, there were particle collisions, but none of the particles in that part of the gap were big enough for the RPWS instrument to detect. Cassini had another useful instrument on board, however, called the Cosmic Dust Analyzer, which could detect particles up to only 1/1,000,000th of a millimeter in size, and this instrument did detect an increase in particle collisions during the flythrough. After passing the ring during the second flythrough, you'll also notice these rising tones. Scientists are unsure what causes these exactly, but it is reminiscent of what Cassini detected earlier in the mission. The other most interesting source of radio and plasma waves around Saturn is actually its moon Enceladus. 2 weeks before Cassini plummeted into Saturn's atmosphere, it captured this as it passed by Enceladus. These observations show that Enceladus and Saturn have a plasma circuit between the two, much like Io and Jupiter, just perhaps to a lesser extent. Although the strength of this plasma circuit surprised scientists greatly. Cassini was also equipped with a magnetometer. This is what it detected by Enceladus. During the flyby of Enceladus, it was able to detect a bending of the magnetic field, indicative of a thin atmosphere, the source of which is likely to be the jets and cryovolcanism near the south pole of the tiny moon. This geological activity draws parallels again to Jupiter's moon Io. The magnetic fields of both planets interact strongly with the ejected atmosphere of the moons, creating a flux tube, or a current of charged plasma particles. There's just one more place that I want to have a look at around the Saturn system, and that is Titan. Cassini's first major objective upon reaching the Saturn system was to launch the Huygens probe towards Saturn's biggest and perhaps most interesting moon, Titan. Although Huygens didn't have its own RPWS instrument, it did have some other instruments. See if you can guess what this is a recording of as it descended towards Titan's surface. If you guessed radar echoes, well done. Huygens used this to determine its altitude above the surface. And what about this? This is perhaps the most impressive of any of the clips I've shown so far. Why? It doesn't sound that impressive until you realize that this is actual audio taken by a microphone on the Huygens probe as it descended through Titan's atmosphere. This is it leaving the vacuum of space and diving into another world. What you are hearing is exactly what you would have heard if you had been sitting on Huygens as it descended. This gives the clip such an awe and perspective like nothing I've heard before. Somehow, it's quite incredible for me to think about. We often have visuals of other planets, but I'm not really sure if there's anything quite like this out there. And there we have it. The sounds of Saturn and a couple of its moons. Think you'd like to learn more about maths and physics, but are worried that it might be a little boring or hard to get into? Well, it doesn't have to be. Something caught my eye this week on Brilliant, an interactive course that uses engaging puzzles to help you learn about physics. Each quiz focuses on solving puzzles that relate to a topic in the natural world. For instance, you can explore the physics of mirror reflections, laser tag, and how to make the perfect shot in a game of pool. With Brilliant, you'll unravel concepts bit by bit and discover deep truths in unexpected places. So give it a go. If you want to support Astrum and get unlimited access to all of Brilliant's interactive math, science, and computer science courses, you can use the link brilliant.org/Astrum to get 20% off their annual premium subscription. Thanks for watching. Subscribe so you don't miss out on space-related videos in the future. And if you really liked it, you can support the channel by becoming a member or through Patreon. Supporters to the channel also get the added perk of helping decide the next Astrum Answers episode in a fortnightly poll. All the best, and see you next time.